Gentlemen, welcome to another dad battle. Now, is anybody, and I mean anybody at all, willing to face our champion?
Gentlemen, my son joined the golf team at school, so I bought him an extra pair of socks in case he gets a hole in one.
Hole in one.
His dad jokes are so effortless.
See that? That's why he's the champ.
That's nothing. The other day, my daughter said a good Christian dad would buy her a car. So I said, well, a good Christian kid would walk, because that's what Jesus did.
Fathers!
Listen up, son. Just because God picked your nose doesn't mean you should.
When you start paying the bills, you can make some of the rules.
Come on!
Yeah. Hold up! Who touched the thermostat? Yeah!
That lawn isn't gonna mow itself.
Let me stop what I'm doing and fix your boredom.
Hi, Hungry. I'm Dad.
I love the smell of Home Depot in the morning.
Yeah. Just wait till your mother gets home.
What? Pull my finger.
You got this.
Come on, champ.
Nah. Just rub some dirt on it.
Yeah.
not proud of you.
You can do hard things.
I love you. No matter what.
When God made you, he made something very special.
The proudest day of my life is the day you made me a father.
I thank God for you every time I get on my knees and pray.
And again,
who gives this woman?
No,
you look at me. You look at me. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and I.
Good morning, church, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there and just father figures. We just thought that'd be kind of funny and just something to laugh about this morning, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers and folks online. We are so happy that you guys are here with us this morning. We just want to remind you and let all the fathers in the room know that your words matter and that you are so valued and important as leaders, not only to your family, but to the people that God has placed around you. You have so much influence and we love you so much and we respect you. We look up to you. So thank you for all that you do. We hope that you all have a blessed day for Father's Day this year. Before we get into the rest of the service, let's just stand up and say hi to the folks around you. Maybe find a new name, shake a hand. Everybody online, say hi to the folks online. Drop in the chat your Father's Day plans. We're so glad that you're here this morning. As we begin this service, let's start in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning. Man, Lord, we thank you for the sunshine and what a beautiful day you have blessed us with. Lord, we thank you for another day to praise you. We thank you for another opportunity to worship you, God, because that is all that we have. That is all that we know how to do, is to just worship you. And so as we sing this morning and as we give you praise, it is all for you, God. Not for ourselves, but for you. And so, Lord, we just lift your name high this morning. We thank you for the people in this room and what you are doing here, God. We love you, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Let's sing.
We worship the God who is. We worship the God.
becomes my greatest defense. It leads me from the dry wilderness, and all I did was praise. All I did was worship. All I did was bow down. Oh, just gonna stay still, stay still.
Almighty God, we praise you and we thank you for who you are. You are the Lord and giver of life. Almighty King, we pray just for those who are sick and who are hurting. Lord, we pray for Lana, that you would bless her and that you would surround her with your love and your grace and with healing. Jesus, we pray for healing in this community. And we pray for healing for the situation in Russia and Ukraine. That you would bring peace in the midst of chaos. God, we thank you for everything that you're doing in this place. We thank you for marriage and for wedding anniversaries. We thank you for the 50th wedding anniversary of Charlie and Peggy Blessy. For the 59th wedding anniversary of Neil and Helen Wright. And for the 65th wedding anniversary of Dean and Joanne Gerhardt. Pray that you would bless them, draw them together towards one another and draw them towards you. Lord, allow them to be an example of your love, of your faithfulness to the people around them. And Almighty God, we do thank you for dads, and we thank you for the gift that you have given to us through them. And Almighty God, we do lift up families that Father's Day could be a little bit tough for them. For those folks who don't necessarily have a relationship with their dad, we pray that you would bring healing. For those who are grieving the loss of their dad, we pray that you would give them hope. God, for those dads who are estranged from their kids, whether it's physically separated or emotionally and spiritually separated, we pray that you would surround them with your love and your grace. And for those who desire to be dads but don't, that necessarily haven't been given that opportunity yet, we pray that you would bless them. We pray that you would work mighty wonders in this world, that people would, they would see your presence and your grace and your mercy, that they would come to you, their heavenly Father. And it's to you that we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. You know, we have an opportunity to go before our God and to confess our sin. Scripture says that if we say we have no sin, we're just deceiving ourselves and the truth isn't in us. But if we confess our sins, our God is faithful and just to forgive us, to cleanse us, to make us new. And so we go before him and we ask him to make us new. Jesus, we need you. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We've sinned against you in our thought and our word and our deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We've not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves, and we justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your way to the glory of your holy name. Church, the good news is this, that your sins are forgiven. That sin and that shame, that guilt that you can hold on to at times, that is all gone. Don't let this moment pass you by. Your Savior, Jesus Christ, has lived and died and rose again for you, so that your sins may be forgiven. Hear what he proclaims to you, that in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, your sins are forgiven. Amen.
Hey friends, with VBS coming up on Monday, I was preparing and I was tying some rope to this bow and I got all tangled up in the rope and now I'm stuck. And since it's so blazing hot out, I want to take off my jacket. But no matter how hard I try, I can't get it off. I'm stuck. Oh, hey, Zach, could you come help me get unstuck here and untie this? I need some help. Oh, thank you. I'm free. You know, this reminds me of how Jesus sets us free. We're stuck in our sin, and no matter how hard we try to get the sin off of us, it doesn't work. We're completely stuck. Our hands are tied until Jesus. Jesus came on this earth. He lived a perfect life, died on the cross, and took the punishment of sin in our place and rose from the dead. He defeated sin and death, and our hands aren't tied anymore. We're no longer stuck in our sin. Jesus sets us free, and because of Jesus, we have no more weight or no more chains holding us down. And we can celebrate today because we are free. Jesus has given us a clean slate. Our hands are no longer tied. See ya.
We are free indeed. Hey, SPL Littles, it is time to go and hear some Jesus time in your own language. There's something I should be saying. Kristen, I'm sorry. I apologize. I messed it up. Pastor Rob, there's SPL Littles right now, just in case you want to know. But hey, there's another thing that is happening this week. There's something big. Say it with me. It's VBS. Yeah! Church, if there is one thing that we should be getting excited about, it is the fact that there are kids who do not yet know Jesus that are coming to this building and they are going to be hearing about Jesus. Yes, that's right. This is a big deal. This is an exciting thing. And if you have not signed up your kids yet, I'm going to get in trouble for saying this, but bring them anyway. Like, just bring them. That's okay. And even if you haven't signed up, Friday evening, there's information in the bulletin. Friday evening, there's like this community party that we're having here. It's going to have games. It's going to have food. I even hear that Pastor Rob and Pastor Mark are going to be in a dunk tank, and that's going to be an exciting thing. Just those two pastors is what I heard. So all three of us. Okay. No, but really, join us. There's information in your bulletin, and we just want you to be a part of that special event. So, hey, let's pray. Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. God, I pray that you would give us the courage to hear what you would have to say to us and to speak what you would have to say to us. We pray that you would be in this time. In your mighty and precious name we pray. Amen. Well, for the next few weeks, we are going to be going through the lectionary readings for our sermons. Now, if you're sitting there thinking, I have no idea what lectionary is, that's okay. I didn't either. Pastor Rob had to tell me. And what a lectionary is, it is a set of readings that are given to different churches. And so as we look at these scriptures that guide our worship, there are a bunch of other churches, not just in Decatur, not just in our country, but throughout the world that are going through these scriptures each week. And so that's kind of an exciting thing is we are using scripture passages that we don't normally use. Now, see, we pastors, we have our favorite scripture passages to preach on. I mean, I don't know how many times I've preached on John 14, but you know that if you told me, hey, Pastor Bill, real quick, preach a sermon, which I don't know who would say that, but if somebody did, if Steve said, preach a sermon, Pastor Bill, I'm going John 14:27 right away because that's one of my favorite passages. That's where I go to. And what this is doing is it's allowing us to take a look at different passages that we may not look at very often because it gives us something different. So we're going to be going through that. And the Gospel of Luke, we're seeing a series of stories that shows how Jesus is for everyone. He's not just for those folks that we think he would be for. He's not just for the ones that look like us or experience things like us or the ones who have the same amount of like middle class income that we may have. Jesus is for everyone. And today we're digging into this passage that talks about how Jesus has freedom that he gives for everyone. That you and me, we are set free by the power of Jesus. And freedom is a big deal today, specifically, because it's not just Father's Day, but it's actually Juneteenth as well, otherwise known as Freedom Day. Now, you may not know specifically what Juneteenth is. That's okay. Juneteenth is a day that is used to commemorate and to celebrate the releasing of slavery in all of the 50 states. So you might know that January 1st, 1863, Abraham Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation, which set free anybody who was held in captivity throughout the Confederate States. That was January 1st, 1863. It wasn't until June 19th, 1865, that order was actually carried out in the last state in Texas. And so we celebrate today that not just is freedom being proclaimed, but freedom is happening in actuality. And if there was a group of people that would ever understand what it means to celebrate being in captivity, being held in control by something, and being set free, it should be the church. We should be able to celebrate that and understand that. But the truth is that while slavery was deemed illegal, there are still those in captivity. In fact, there's a statistic that says that 24.9 million people are still victims of human trafficking throughout the world. They're still being held in captivity. And that's not counting those folks who are not just held enslaved by other people, but held enslaved by their own sinful thoughts and desires. There are people in this room, there are people in this church and in this community who are held captive by the bottle. They know that they shouldn't drink that alcohol, but they're held in control by it. There are people in this community, in this church, who know that they shouldn't go look at that stuff online, but they're held captive by it. There are people in this world who are held captive by depression and by thoughts of suicide, by fear and by anxiety. There are people today who are held captive by fear. And in this world, in this time, we should be the people. The church should be the people that brings freedom to all who are held captive. And our passage in Luke today is a passage that is all about that kind of freedom. See, we're called as a church to love those people who are bound emotionally and spiritually and physically. We as the church are people who should help others find freedom. But friends, if we are not communicating the freedom that Jesus brings, then we're not proclaiming freedom. See, this world is capable of releasing people from their chains, but only Jesus is capable of bringing true freedom. And we know this is true. Jesus says it, who the Son sets free is free indeed. It is Jesus that is bringing freedom into our lives. And so we're going to learn about this guy who is getting freedom brought into his lives. I'd invite you to open up your Bibles, Luke chapter 8. We've got pew Bibles in front of you. You can use your phone Bible app. That's okay too. Luke chapter 8. When someone gets there, will you shout out the page number? 865? Awesome, thank you. 865, we are going to Luke chapter 8. So here's how this is going to work. We're just going to read a little bit of scripture. I'm going to talk about it for a little bit, and then we'll read some more scripture, and then we'll just keep going back and forth. Does that sound good? We're going there. Luke chapter 28, verse 26. Then they, meaning Jesus and his disciples, sailed to the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. Now, for context, remember that Jesus has been teaching and preaching and doing miracles in Galilee. And one day he stands up and he says, hey, we're going to go to the other side of the lake. And as they get into the boat to sail to the other side of the lake, Jesus has been working hard, and so he falls asleep. As he falls asleep, the winds start picking up, the waves start crashing over the side. The disciples start to become really afraid, and so they wake Jesus up, and Jesus kind of scolds them a little bit, saying, don't you trust me? And so he gets up and he speaks to the waves. He says, peace, be still. And what happens? The waves are still. And it's right after this account that Jesus makes it, they make it to the other side of the lake, and they land in the land of the Gerasenes, which is a non-Jewish territory. This is a place where maybe the disciples were feeling a little bit out of sorts. They didn't necessarily think that they belonged there. It's one of those places where maybe you wouldn't go there after night or after the sunset, you know? Once it gets dark, this is probably not a safe place, Jesus, especially not for us. There were a bunch of people that were avoiding this place, but Jesus just went right in because he knew he was being called to that place. And so when Jesus had stepped out onto land, there he met a man from the city who had demons. For a long time, he'd worn no clothes, and he had not lived in a house, but among the tombs. See, this man was held captive by spirits and by unclean things. They were the things that were in control. He didn't wear clothes, which probably got pretty cold at night and provided absolutely no protection from the sun during the day. And he lived away from people in total and complete isolation in what was considered an unclean place, full of death, full of decay. And just a few verses later, we hear that this demon would seize him, and he would be so out of control that people would chain him up with shackles, but the demons would break them, and they would drive him out into the wilderness, into the desert, into the Midbar, right? He'd drive him out into this place of isolation. I think of that, the Lion King movie, right? Where the hyenas live. The elephant graveyard. This is a place that no one was supposed to go. This is the kind of place that he was being driven out into. And when he saw Jesus, he cried out and he fell down before him and he said with a loud voice, what have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me. For he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of him. For many a times it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. And he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the desert. Jesus then asked him, what is your name? And he said, Legion, for many demons had entered him. So Jesus sees this guy, someone Jesus shouldn't talk to, and a place that Jesus shouldn't be, and a place that this man shouldn't be, and yet Jesus goes up to him. He looks at this man with compassion and care and with authority. He commands that the demons leave. And the demons ask, what are you going to do with us, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? See, they know who Jesus is. They know what he can do. So they ask him, can you at least be kind to us? They're afraid. But instead, Jesus asks what their name is, and they respond with the name Legion. Legion being that term for about 3,000 to 6,000 men. So what we see is not a man who's been possessed by one or two demons. No, we're seeing a guy who has been controlled and enslaved by something that was incredibly overwhelming. And they begged him, the demons begged him not to command them to depart into the abyss. But a large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him to let them enter these. And so he gave them permission. The book of Mark said there was about 2,000 pigs there. This was a big herd of pigs. This was their the livestock. This was how they were earning income. This was important meat. And the demons asked, can we at least be thrown in there? See, this is going to be a whole lot better than being thrown into the abyss, into torment, into hell. And so they said, can we be thrown into these pigs? And what I find so incredibly interesting is that Jesus had compassion on them and agreed to do it. Like, he had compassion on these demons. I don't know if you ever feel like there is someone who like doesn't deserve compassion, or if you ever feel like, man, I have done too much to receive God's compassion. Jesus had compassion on these demons, and he allowed them to go into the pigs. Then the demons came out of the man, entered the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and drowned. See, Jesus gave them what they wanted, and even left up to their own desires, it still led them to death. But when the pigs' herdsmen saw what had happened, they fled, and they told it in the cities and in the countries, and then people went out to see what had happened. They came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And those who had seen it told them how the demon-possessed man had been healed. And all the people of the surrounding countries of the Gerasenes asked him to depart from them, for they were seized with great fear. And so he got into the boat and returned. But the man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." And he went away proclaiming throughout the whole city how much he had done for him. So Jesus brings freedom to this man by the words that he proclaimed. He said, "You are free," and he was free. And yet to this town who had just lost 2,000 pigs and a whole lot of income, this seemed like a bad thing. And so they asked him to leave. They were angry, they were furious, "Get out of here." So much so that Jesus agreed to leave. But for that one man, the one man who never thought that he would be clean again, the one man who was freed, the one man who had the word of God spoken over him and his chains released, that one man, he begged for Jesus to stay, or at least to take him with him. Maybe there was this fear that the demons would come back. I don't know, but I think it was out of gratitude. There was this thankfulness. There was this joy. "Thank you so much for the work that you have done in my life." He longed to be in the presence of Jesus. And Jesus says to him, "No, go and tell people what I've done." Church, Jesus is doing good things here and now. I know that if you watch the news, you'll see a lot of negative things that are happening. But here and now, Jesus is working in mighty ways. There is freedom being proclaimed to those who are captive. There is freedom being brought to those who are being held against their will by addictions. There are people who are being freed from depression. There are people who are feeling Jesus' peace in the midst of their anxiety. There are people that God is working in. He is freeing people here and now. Jesus brings freedom. And so my question for you is this. If Jesus is bringing freedom here and now, then where do you find yourself in that story? Where do you see yourself in the story of Jesus bringing freedom to the demoniac? Do you see yourself in the crowd? Where you look around and you see Jesus doing good things, incredible things, setting people free for other people, bringing blessing upon blessing to other people, and you look around and you start to play that comparison game. You look around at Jesus bringing freedom to someone and you say, that's going to hurt our reputation. That's going to hurt our income. Or maybe you look around and you say, I can't believe he's working in their life. Why isn't he working in my life? And you become angry or bitter or jealous. Do you see yourself in the crowd? I know I do at times. I mean, the truth is, today is Father's Day. And to be honest, I was hoping that by now, I'd be able to celebrate Father's Day. But God, in his infinite wisdom and his mercy, he is in control and in his plan. I recognize that. He hasn't made that happen yet. And that's okay, but there are times where I see that and I can become jealous or frustrated. You with me on that? Maybe it's not that you are wanting a kid. Maybe it's that you see how God is working in another relationship. You say, God, why aren't you doing that in my relationship? Or maybe it's that you see God working and providing the relation or the work status or the position at the job, and they say, God, why did they get that and I didn't? Or maybe you look around and you think, why didn't I get that house or that promotion or whatever? Maybe it's a trait, right? Can't believe I can't wear flannel like Pastor Bill can, you know? God's at work. But are you so busy looking at the people around you that you fail to recognize what he's doing here and now? Are you in the crowd? Or do you see yourself in the man who has been set free? In the one who recognizes that God has worked in his life in a mighty and incredible way and has responded with joy and with gratitude and with thanksgiving, with excitement. The one who longs to be in the presence of Jesus because he knows that God is up to something incredible. Church, God has done incredible things in your life. He has set you free. I know that at times it's hard to believe, and I know that sometimes the chains that we carry around, removing those chains is a lifelong process. I know that it doesn't feel like the anxiety is going away or the depression is going away or the addiction is going away, but he has unlocked that chain. And it is not those things that have control of us anymore. It is the Spirit of the living God that dwells among us. Amen? Who the Son sets free is free indeed. And so my question is, are you going to be the person that looks around and compares what you have to everybody else? Or are you going to respond with gratitude and joy and thanksgiving for what God has already done here and now? And my prayer is that as a church, we would be that people that respond with joy and gratitude. Look at what Jesus tells this guy to do. He says, return to your home, declare how much God done for you. And when he went away, he proclaimed throughout the whole city how much he had done. May we be the church that proclaims what God has done in our lives to the people around us, so that they too might see what God is doing in their lives. God is up to something incredible here in Decatur. May we be the church that excitedly, rejoicingly, gratefully proclaims it. Amen. Jesus, we thank you for who you are. You are the Lord and giver of life. You are the one that provides. You are the one that brings freedom. You break our chains. And so, Lord, help us to see that. Help us to experience that. Help us to be grateful and thankful for it. Help us to chase after you with unending joy. And help us to follow your lead in going and proclaiming to the world around us. We pray this in your mighty and precious name. Amen. Hey, I would invite you to stand as we go before our King in worship. invite you to put your arms around the people next to you and receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his unending peace. Amen. Amen. Hey, thank you for worshiping with us today. Go in peace and serve our Lord. Amen.